Father, I just thank you for this morning already, Lord. It's been such a blessing. I thank you that, God, I see the body working. And that's what you want from all churches, Lord, is not a person running everything, running the show like Ian just said, or people elevating themselves with positions and names as if it's all about them, or a bunch of people sat down letting those people do that stuff while they receive people. That's not the way church should be. Church should not be a place that we just come and take. It should be a place where we give together, and in giving we receive. And so, Lord, I just thank you that we see that. We've seen that this morning. We've seen different people do different things this morning, and that's the heart. That's the heart of this church, the heart of the leadership and the membership, is that we want to see the body used. We want to see it working together. It's not about one person or a few people. It really is about the body working. And your word is very clear, that if the body does what it should be doing, if it loves one another the way Jesus instructed, then people will see. People will look in. People will see that they are your disciples, that we are your disciples. And then what happens in Acts? Acts says that they were added to. And so, Lord, sometimes we run around like headless chickens trying to do so much stuff in your name. And yet, really what we need to get down to is loving one another, serving one another, being with each other. And then Lord, it actually says that people were added in that function. So God, let us be a church. Let us be a people that love one another with that love that you set, that standard that you set. And Lord, I know, Lord, as we do that, it will break down so many things and it will change so many lives. And the people that are outside looking in will be impacted and affected. So I thank you for this morning already, Lord. I just pray that you would use this word to encourage, to stir up, to challenge the people that are here and anyone that will be listening in the future. Amen. We only got 11 pages, so it'll be alright. Ian took away some of my time. Just that 3 minutes. Alright, today we're going to look at the story of Jericho, okay? So it's in Joshua. We're going to read from a little bit of 5 all the way through to 8, chapter 8. We're not going to read all of it, so don't worry about that. But it's going to include the whole of those chapters, and it's for good reason. So, anyone that comes to our Bible study on a Wednesday will know that what we're learning, or what we should have, we really have learned by now, we don't really need to learn it anymore, is that as we read the Word of God, that we can read, say, one verse, or a little bit of a chapter, or we can read a whole chapter even, and still get it wrong, because we don't read it in context. We read it and we say, oh, I'll take that, that sounds really great. That I can put that into my life and it makes me feel good and it gives me justification for this and justification for that. And in the world today, the word is twisted so much. You know, the devil, when he was tempting Jesus in the desert, used scripture to try and twist the scripture, to try and tempt him, to try and drag him down. The world today, whether it's churches, and there are churches that do it, or whether it's even the world that will come back at Christians, like you and me, as we challenge them, we use the scripture to twist it. And if we don't know it, we will be condemned. Because we have a heart. If you're a follower of Jesus, you have a soft heart. You have a heart where God is doing a work in you. And then when someone says, but the Bible says this, and you think, well, yeah, that's the standard, right? Then you can live in a position of being condemned because you don't really know what is being said. So you can challenge somebody that's in the world, or you can challenge somebody that's in the church, and they can come out with one line of scripture, and if you don't know what that really means, you can sit there and go, wow, I really shouldn't have done that, I shouldn't have said that, I shouldn't. And yet you know, you think, I think I was right, I think that's what God wanted me to say or wanted me to do. But people want to use the word to justify sometimes their sin, justify what they're shouldn't be doing, like to justify what they're doing and they shouldn't be doing. And so what we're learning, what we've learned, is read around it. read around the scripture. So in the story of Joshua, you have, anyone tell me a story that is linked to Joshua that you know off the top of your head?
Jericho.
Yeah, first thing that really comes to a lot of people's head is the story of Jericho. And so what we would do is we think, right, where's Jericho? Where's the story of Jericho? Let's go and read that story, which is what I was doing yesterday. And you go straight to chapter 6. But what we're going to do is we're going to actually read a little bit before. Because I think if you read a little bit before, it explains a lot more. In fact, it probably explains perfectly what was going on with the story of Jericho. I'm going to try not to listen to a Bible study because I'm trying to be a preacher today. And it's really hard. As I started to read the Word, as I started to look at things, I started to realize, wow, God, you're showing all this stuff. And it's like it can easily turn into a Bible study, and then it gets a bit more deeper. We want to sit down and discuss that stuff. So I'm going to keep it light, which means I'm going to do a part two on this, which will be a study thing on a Wednesday, because there is so much in here that I'm not going to share that I believe is going to be very exciting and encouraging, and maybe other words I can't think of right now. Okay, so in Joshua 5, verse 13, it says this, "And it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted his eyes and looked, and behold, a man stood opposite him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went to him and said to him, Are you for us or are you our adversaries? So he said, No, but as commander of the army of the Lord, I have now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and worshipped and said to him, What does my Lord say to his servant? Then the commander of the Lord's army said to Joshua, Take your sandal off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy. And Joshua did so." Who's this guy?
Yes.
I'm so glad someone said that, because I did think it was, but I was thinking, oh no. We know this is Jesus, which is pretty awesome. Who knew that he turned up before his ministry? He was around in the Old Testament. There's other stories of Jesus turning up. So Joshua meets the commander of the army of the Lord. This is an encounter with Jesus himself. How do we know this? Jesus fell on his face to the ground, and the commander told him to take his sandals off, for the place he stood is holy. The word commander in Hebrew translates prince, ruler, leader, chief, chieftain, official, captain. We know that most of those words are used to explain Jesus in the Word of God. Prince, Prince of Peace, ruler, God rules over the nations. One down. Captain. In Hebrews 2:10, it translates that Jesus is the captain, which is the author of our salvation. And he means that he's chief among all other gods. Especially in the Old Testament, there was always false gods, there's always things going on that people were worshipping. Jesus trumps them all. He's the chief, he's the king, he's the ruler over all. So before chapter 6, the exciting story of the Battle of Jericho, we find right at the end of chapter 5, Jesus meeting with Joshua. Did anyone remember, know that that was part of the story of Jericho? Didn't we have that school in Sunday school, did we? Jesus meets Joshua before he goes into Jericho. Okay. It's pretty cool, isn't it? We're going to come back to that story because it's key, very key to what happens next. So I'm just going to read bits and then I'm going to paraphrase through the chapters in the bits in between, otherwise we'll be here forever. Now Jericho, so this is chapter 6, now Jericho was securely shut up because the children of Israel, none went out and none came in. And the Lord said to Joshua, "See, I have given Jericho into your hand, its king, and the mighty men of valor. You shall march around the city, all you men of war. You shall go all around the city once. This you shall do 6 days. And 7 priests shall bear 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark. But the 7th day you shall march around the city 7 times, and the priest shall blow the trumpets. It shall come to pass when they make a long blast with a ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, that all the people shall shout with a great shout. Then the wall of the city will fall down flat, and the people shall go up, every man straight before him. So it says the wall of the city will fall down flat. In Jericho, so Jericho is believed to be one of the oldest cities in the world. Its name is taken from the Hebrew word which means moon. And many believe that it is linked to the lunar god Jericho, maybe, for whom the city was the early center of worship. Jericho is the lord of the sickle, which is linked to the symbol of the crescent moon. It's interesting, isn't it? Where can we link that to? So we see that this is a city, is a place of worship to a false god, a center of worship which is fortified and securely shut up. Okay. So this place right now, isn't it? This place that we've got, that they're facing, it's not just a city, it's a city that is proclaiming against God. It's lifting up another God. It's a center, this is what people believe, a center of worship, which sounds quite big, doesn't it? It sounds like a place where you've got a whole city centered around worshiping a false God. And a false God that links to future false gods, doesn't it? So Jesus, God explains what he wants them to do. And then if you go to verse 12, it says this. And Joshua rose early in the morning, and the priests took up the ark of the Lord, and the seven priests bearing seven trumpets of ram's horns before the ark of the Lord went on continually and blew the trumpets. And the armed men went before them, but the rear guard after the ark of the Lord, while the priests continued blowing the trumpets. And the second day they marched around the city once, and returned to camp. So they did 6 days. But it came to pass on the seventh day that they rose early about the dawning of the day and marched around the city 7 times in the same manner. On that day, only they marched around the city 7 times. And the seventh time happened when the priest blew the trumpets that Joshua said to the people, shout, for the Lord has given you the city. Now the city shall be doomed by the Lord to destruction, it and all who are in it. Now there's a bit about Rahab and stuff, but I'm not going to share that today because I feel like that's something I'm going to share in the study. But if you go to verse 18, it says, and you by all means abstain from the accursed things, lest you become accursed when you take of the accursed things and make the camp of Israel a curse and trouble it. But all the silver and gold and vessels of bronze and iron are consecrated to the Lord. They shall come into the treasury of the Lord. So the people shouted when the priest blew the trumpets, and it happened when the people heard the sound of the trumpets, and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell down flat. Then the people went up into the city, and every man straight before him, and they took the city, and it utterly destroyed all that was in the city, both men, women, young, old, ox, sheep, donkey, with the edge of the sword. What God does is he tells them how. He says, this is what you're going to do. So they walk around the city. But he also gives conditions. He says, once it's done, once I've done my bit and made it nice and easy for you, when you go in there, you are going to wipe it out. I don't want anything left other than the bit I'm telling you to set aside for me. God says, you give me an offering and then destroy the rest. That's the condition. Okay, so it's not a case of they got there and it's like, oh yeah, God said it's okay to have a bit of this and a bit of that. That was the condition. Get rid of everything apart from the bit I'm telling you to set aside for me. So it wasn't even there, it was set aside for God. And a few weeks back, I talked about the first fruits, if you remember that. And this is one of those things. In fact, it's a good example of God's first fruits with the first attack of the people going into Israel. That God says, set that bit aside for me. And there's going to be, I think, an interesting Bible study that will go deeper into that on one of the Wednesdays. Okay. Then he goes into about Joshua and the spies and Rahab again. So and then if you go to 26, it says that Joshua charged them at that time, saying, "Cursed be the man before the Lord who rises up and builds his city, Jericho. He shall lay his foundation with his firstborn, and with his youngest he shall set up his gates." So the Lord was with Joshua, and fame spread throughout the country. Right, so another thing, another condition is, don't rebuild these walls. I've knocked them down for a reason. Don't put them back up, and anyone that does will be cursed. Okay? And that's the conditions, okay? Right, now I'm going to just paraphrase through 7 and 8 or 7. So this is, so they win a great victory, yeah, in Jericho. A great victory. Can you imagine walking around some walls, blowing some trumpets? They come down and defeat your enemy. It's a great victory with the miraculous. Okay? Then, for some strange reason, they lose their next battle. They get defeated. And Joshua, let's see if I can find it. There's a lot of scripture here. Joshua gets a little bit upset. So right at the end of verse chapter 7, oh, not the end, in verse 6, yeah, verse 6, 7, 8, 9, it says, "Then Joshua tore his clothes and fell on the earth," that he'd just been defeated, okay? "Fell on the earth and his face before the ark of the Lord until evening, and he and the elders of Israel, and they put dust on their heads." A bit weird. "And Joshua said, 'Alas, Lord God, why have you brought this people over the Jordan at all to deliver us into the hands of the Amorites to destroy us? Oh, that we had been content and dwell on the other side of the Jordan. O Lord, what shall I say when the Israel turns its back before its enemies? For the Canaanites and all its inhabitants of the land were here and surround us and cut off our name from the earth. Then what will you do for your great name?'" You see, Joshua was saying, we were alright on the other side of the Jordan, but he told us to go across, and then a miracle involved in that, wasn't there? And then he's sort of saying, why did you do that? What was the point of doing all that if now we're going to just be defeated? What was the point? I did write a lot. Okay, I'm just gonna work it in. So what God does is he says, "Hang on a minute, Joshua, calm down." Is what he does. He says, "Calm down." He says, "You guys have sinned. You haven't done what I told you to do." So Joshua's moaning because something's not happening the way he thought it should happen. And God is saying, "Hang on a minute. This is your problem. This is you. You've done this." And so he says, "Look, someone amongst you has stolen. Somebody here has done what I told you not to do." And so what he does is he finds out who this guy is, and he. I feel like I've just cut a load of my message out by just not reading my notes. Right. So what happens is God does a miracle in Jericho. God does this amazing thing He gives conditions. He says, do this. I'm going to do my bit. You do your bit, but don't do that. And they do it, or someone does it. And the guy that does it is called Achan. And basically God tells Joshua, he says, look, this is why you lost the battle, the next battle. You need to find out what the problem is, deal with it. And if you deal with it, then we can talk about putting things right. But if you don't, then I'm out. It's literally what God says. If you read in chapter 7, it says, neither I will be with you anymore unless you destroy the accursed from among you. That's pretty harsh, isn't it? But God's clear. When he gives us instructions, when God says what we should and shouldn't do, there's reasons for it. And it's not just about following a bunch of rules all the time. It's for our own good. It's for purposes. It's for reasons. God sees further than we see. Amen? He sees all of it. We see this far, don't we? In front of our nose. And yet we think we know more than God. And yet you can imagine with Achan, he's there, and he's thinking, he's gone into the enemy camp, the enemy's been defeated, amongst there is all this stuff that starts turning him. So the enemy is still at work in the victory. The enemy is the temptation to draw you away, even in the midst of a great victory, is there to distract you. How many times have you gone to a meeting, say a church meeting, maybe you've gone to a Christian camp or an event or some kind of thing, and actually in the midst of something that God does something pretty amazing and awesome in your life, you get the end, you feel like, wow, where does that come from? I feel like I'm in a really good place with God right now. Where does that temptation come from? Where's this just suddenly appeared from? It's because in the midst of your victory, the enemy doesn't say, okay, he's still going to try it. He's still going to have things around, dotted about to distract you, to say, I know that's been destroyed, but why not pick it up again? You know, when we have when God breaks down the walls in our lives, it's kind of like we go about it, we say, oh yeah, victory, that's been broken down. And then we kind of actually walk in and it's like we start building the wall back up. And that's what Achan did. It's like he undid what was undoing what God had already done. Sin, the word everyone hates to hear, but everyone loves to do. I made that up. I'm sure someone else has made that up before. But that word sin is not used enough in church. It is not used, done enough in church, but it's not used enough in church. It's not spoken from here enough. It's not brought forward that we would have an attitude and a mindset to say that's not what God wants me to do. But what happens is people try to justify their sin. Like I said before, they'll twist scripture or they'll twist other bits and pieces to allow them to get away with doing certain things that God is clearly saying is against his word and against his will. I believe God wants us to grow up. I believe that God is saying it's time for you to kind of realize what sin really is and how the temptation of this world, the work of the enemy is very real. I think people feel that Christianity and the work of the enemy, we talk about the devil, or maybe what's being portrayed on telly, I don't know, it's like a fairy tale part of Christianity. It's not. It's a reality. It's real. It's right there. And I think sometimes we walk in, oh yeah, God's given me the victory. And we walk around in a way of like, God's got my back. And that's all great. Yeah, God's with us. But he's also saying, be vigilant, be aware. Because the enemy, God doesn't just say, oh no, that's it. Look at the story of Job. You know, there's a conversation between God and the devil where he's saying, go on then. You know, the enemy is not going to stop working because you suddenly raise the level of what you do. In fact, it's going to get worse if you do, because you're going to be doing more to affect the kingdom of God, so you're going to be a target. That is probably why we try and be happy on the other side of the Jordan, content a lot of the time. God wants us on the right side of the Jordan, where we should be, in the midst of the battle. But we also need to understand that in the midst of the battle, the sin is going, nature is going to come out, the temptations are going to come out, in the midst of the great victories that God is doing in your life. Achan's family is stoned and caught on fire. Sounds bad, doesn't it? Thank God that we're not in that anymore. They then make a memorial stone and name the place in the valley of Achor, which means, does anyone know what it means?
Trouble.
So they stone Achan and his family, and they bury him with stones, and it's a memorial stone that's known in the Valley of Trouble. It's there, it's called the Valley of Trouble, and it's a memorial stone that's there that says, that's a remarker and a reminder of what happens when we disobey God. Now, I don't want anyone to get condemned, and I don't want anyone to live a world where they have to remember everything, but our sin is removed as far as the east is from the west, yeah? No doubt. The consequences of our actions, however, still exist. That true? Yeah. It's important to understand that while grace, mercy, and forgiveness remain, that the consequences of our sin also remain. I think it's important that we all have a memorial in our lives, whether it's in our minds, our hearts, called trouble. Not that we get condemned, not that we go back to it all the time, not that we keep picking it up and saying, oh yeah, I've got a memorial, I need to dwell on my sin and all the things I did wrong, but to remind us of what? Not to do it again. How many people here go back to the place of trouble, pick it all up again, take it all on board, and make the same mistake again, and the same mistake again? Yeah, Harry's very happy about that. That's very honest, very honest. Harry's, yeah. There's not any of us that cannot say that we don't do that at some stage in our life, where we go back to the place of trouble and take all the stones off and resurrect the very thing that's been buried. And it's been buried to remind us that don't go back there. So Jesus, God has put these things out there for us to say, build this as a memorial of a place of trouble. He's not saying, oh, that's gone now. He's saying, it's dealt with, but remember the consequences if you don't follow my will. Now the enemy will seek to destroy you at every given opportunity he wants you. Your family, your money, your relationships, your jobs, your homes, he wants it all. Do not be under the illusion that you are in control. God should be in control, and also remember being reminded that the enemy is always out to devour. Be on your guard. Be aware that that is happening. You know, as we step out, you know, Joe stepped out today, Anthony stepped out today. As people step out and do something that's a bit outside of their comfort zone, do not be under the illusion of thinking like, oh, that was pretty good, I think I've arrived. Be under the absolute awareness that as you guys, and you guys in particular today, have done something that's going to push you, hopefully, to say, I can do that, I can go a little bit more, I can do a bit more. The enemy is going to be trying to get at you. Be aware of that, and then you can take tag of him, because you've got God. But if you're not aware of it, it will come in and it will sideswipe you and you won't be aware. And that's what happened with Achan. He wasn't focusing on Jesus, he wasn't focusing on God. He was looking around at all the stuff, and the enemy distracted him from the victory. And in the midst of a great victory, Achan brought, huge consequences. Another thing with our sin, what does it do? It doesn't just affect us. 36, but I might be wrong. People died in that battle. So that battle was a loss because they were not walking in the will of God. They were not walking in the will of God because one man chose to go against the will of God. He didn't lose his life at that point. 36 other people did. And they lost a battle. Our sin doesn't just affect ourselves as well. It affects everyone around us. It affects our lack of walking in the will of God at times does have an impact on other people. We need to realize that. That's scary. It's scary to think that sometimes God is asking us to step out and speak to somebody because it's you that he wants to do it, because that person needs to hear it. It's scary to think that if we don't walk in the will of God sometimes, that person, what they needed at that moment, don't get it. God will get there somewhere, somehow, in some way, I'm sure. We need to realize that we have a great privilege to be able to represent God in this life. But if we really choose to do it, it isn't this lovely, plain sailing, beautiful, airy-fairy Christianity that we... It's hard, it's tough. It's going to challenge us. The consequences can be huge. This isn't so you feel condemned. This isn't a condemning message. This isn't to say, like, you're not doing good enough. This is a message to say, look, if we do it our way, it sucks. And it doesn't end well. But if we do it his way, which we'll get to a little bit further along in a minute, you'll see the results of what can happen. So they get back on track. Amen? Do you know that? They get back on track. God says, all right, okay, let's go meet these people now. We can do this. And what's great about this is God sets up this awesome strategic battle to defeat. God tells us how he's going to do it, and it is pretty good. I mean, if you were going to watch a wartime movie, and, you know, it's that kind of strategy, you're watching, you think, oh, this is great. And they pretend to be weak, they pretend to draw out the army, they all leave the city because they've already defeated them once. They think, oh, these guys are easy pickings. It's amazing. The enemy comes out to try and destroy the people of God, but God's got a plan in it. And there's absolute victory in it. They conquer Ai and kill the king. Then they place his body at the gates, like the Aunt Acre one, the trouble. Lay stones over him as a memorial at the gate. And at that place, Ai is known as Ruins. I don't know if it was named Ruins after they ruined it, but that's what it's known as. So you have, in the space of a short period of time, two sets of memorials. You have one signifies trouble, and you can look at that and say, wow, that was that guy, Acor, that we didn't want to do what he did. And then they win a victory, they kill the king, they bury the king in a similar fashion, they build a memorial stone that basically is at the gates of this place which is known as Ruin. But what is the ruin of? It's the ruin of the enemy, it's the ruin of the work of the enemy against us, against them. It's destroyed, it's dealt with. And so it's a victory memorial stone. So they have one that they can look at and say, we don't want to do that. We have one that they can look at and say, but if we follow the will of God, look what God does. He brings and puts the enemies in our hands that we can defeat them. Now listen to this. What did God say the first time about this stuff? About taking things from the city of Jericho? What did God say? Don't take it. Don't take stuff. Set aside some for me, get rid of it, burn the rest, basically, is what it says. What does he say about Ai? The next place. What does he say to them? Does anyone know? If you go to verse 2 of chapter 8, and you shall do to Ai and its king as you did to Jericho and its king. Only, he's basically saying, only this time, its spoils and its cattle you shall take as your booty. word made me laugh when I was doing it. He said, mature Claire, your beauty for yourself. You can take this, this part of it is yours. Do you see what happened to Achan? What happened to Achan? He was destroyed. He the consequences of his sin were that he failed to see God's plan and God's purpose. But what happened to Achan was he went into a place of great victory, was distracted by the temptation and not a willingness to listen to the will of God, although he had been instructed. He took for himself, it's called consequences on himself and consequences on the Israelites, and then he dies because of it. The very next place that they're going to defeat, had they not done that, God would have said, everything is yours. This one's yours. Do you see? As God asks us to step out in obedience in our lives, has anyone done this? I've done it plenty of times where you say, okay, God, I'm ready. Let's go. And you get pumped and you go and do what you feel God is telling you to do. You step out in what God is telling you to do. And then you think, but this isn't the way I thought you were going to do it, God. I'm all up for doing what you want me to do as long as you do it the way I've worked out in my brain that you should be doing it. So we step out for God, we have a bit of a pump, we say, yeah, I'm ready, we go for it. It doesn't work out the way we thought it should work out, because we think we know better than God. We lose the blessings. We lose the blessing that God had for us, because it was just waiting around the corner. It was just there. What I want to say to you is, when you step out in obedience to God, it's not always going to make sense. I've got a few people to start meeting across on Switchblade. And I would love the whole church to start reading it, really. So the book's going around somewhere. Page, I'll go and read it and then pass it on to someone else. But what that starts off with is the story of David Wilkerson's ministry, where he steps out and does something in obedience to God. He knows it's God telling him to do it, and it all goes wrong. It all goes wrong because he thinks it's the way God, I'll go in there, I'll do it my way, it'll work out. And he goes and does it that way. He's in obedience to God, but it doesn't work out the way he thought. In fact, it's a disaster. Tasha's nodding, she's been listening. It's an absolute disaster. But was it a disaster? No. Because what God told him to do, he was obedient. It didn't work out the way he thought, but he knew it was God. Basically, he gets put on the front page of the newspaper, effectively being kicked out of court, and it's all over the newspaper. He's from a church like this, he's just says, well, I'm going to go into the city, and he goes to speak to some kids that have been arrested, and he thinks that by being a pastor standing up in the courtroom will give him some kind of authority, and it doesn't work out that way, and he gets kicked out of the church, out of the courtroom. He gets effectively put on the front page of the newspaper, and he shames his church, and he shames his parents, and he shames everyone, and they're all like, please don't do that again. And he doesn't think, what I felt that was God. And in the midst of that, he knows God's calling him. So even though everyone's telling him, don't, please, just stick with the nice, quiet, easy life. Please just do what you're told. And he's like, I can't, because God's telling me to do something. And I don't know why, because it really didn't go well the first time, but I'm going to try a second time. And he goes down into New York again. And this time, he's walking around, and he feels God tells him to get out of the car. And he's like, I don't know what's going on, but I'm going to do it. And he gets out of the car. And as he does that, somebody goes, David. And these kids know who he is. And these are the very kids that he's trying to reach, that he felt God was asking him to reach. They knew him. Why? Because his name and his picture was plastered all over the newspaper, and it broke down a barrier that no one could break. There, in the human way, it broke down a barrier between kids on the streets, drug addicts, and people that were killing people with knives, gangs. It broke down that barrier immediately between a church or between a pastor and those kids, because they thought he was brilliant, because he had stood up for them. And it got plastered all over the national papers. His way of thinking, my way of thinking would be like, I'll go in, I'll stand up, I'll preach the gospel, everyone can get saved. Thank you, Lord. That's what we want to, that's what we think would be a lovely way of doing it. God's way is saying, be obedient to me, still stay obedient to me, keep listening to the Holy Spirit that's going to be speaking to you, and follow it, because you do not know why I am doing this right now, but you will get it. And if Achan had just waited, if he had just had that same attitude, he only had to wait a little bit longer to realize why God has said what he said, and he would have received the blessing that he was trying to steal for himself the very next battle. See, God isn't a God that says, oh, I'll take everything, thanks for fighting for me. God has reasons and purposes for it. There's always, he knows what's best for us, and he sees further.